Come to order, please. Good morning, welcome to the Commission of St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, February 23rd, 2016. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commission of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other commissioners. Sitting on the side of the table, representing the First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George's Island, Commissioner Tom Jarbo.
Good morning.
Representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown, Hollywood, Commissioner Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
Sitting to my immediate left is representing the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, Seventh District, Golden Beach, Commissioner John O'Connor.
Good morning.
Sitting next to him, representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Summit, California, and Great Mills, Commissioner Todd Morgan. Sitting next to Commissioner Morgan at the end of the table is our County Administrator, Dr. Bridget.
Good morning.
On my immediate right is Sharon Ferris, our recorder, and behind the glass, which you don't see very often, is Miss Amy Carter. She's our videographer, and she's behind the glass, like I say. Now, please come up to look good, smile, because you're on TV. Please turn your cell phone off or on vibrate. When you come to the microphone or presenter's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. Reminder, we have public hearing for Code Home Rule tonight at 2nd District Volunteer Fire Department, 45245 Drayden Road, Valley Lee, Maryland. At this time, we'll have our invocation and pledge by Commissioner Hewitt. Please stand.
All right, dear Lord, I talked to you this morning, but I'm going to talk to you again. Thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you for no snow. Just to remind you, the groundhog didn't see his shadow, so please bring spring as early as you can. On a more profound note, thank you for these great people here, these people of this county. Give us the strength and the wisdom to do the right thing, make the correct decisions, and do the best we can. Thank you. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Hood. This time, I'd like to have approval of our last minutes, please.
I move to approve the minutes of February 9th, 2016, as presented.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
So moved. Next, we have the Department of Economic Development presentation of our 2016-2017 Technology Handbook for St. Mary's County.
And if the commissioners will join Economic Development in the front of the presentation, that would be great.
Ms. Castellanos, Finicom, yeah, but all join us, please.
He's the money man.
So let me just say, first of all, the Technology Handbook is a really, really nice publication. It lists over 180 technology firms. It's a great marketing piece for economic development. It's also good for job seekers. It lists a lot of good resource information for each company, and it's got a beautiful cover. I want to thank Robin Finicum who led this project, and we do it every other year now. It's the first year we've done it in color. It's just a beautiful publication. I thank you, and I'll turn it over.
Yes, we have a lot of firsts for this year's edition. It is the first one we've done in color, which really helped because we could put all the company's logos in color. Of course, the commissioner's portrait in the front really pops. The other thing is we've included a map in the back of Pax River. You guys look great. A map of Pax River in the back that gives a full detail of, you know, the base itself. Of course, I can't find it. Throughout the book, there are historical facts and little interesting pieces about St. Mary's County, such as, you know, our love for stuffed ham and other historical things. We also have a listing of the base itself and its history, which some of us know, but for others who may be coming to our community for the first time, you know, understanding when it opened and the different programs that are there is always exciting. Right. And finally, in the far back, we have an index, and one of the people, companies from last year, had asked that we put together the index in such a way that if you're looking for a company that's veteran-owned or women-owned, you can quickly find that in the directory. So that's a very helpful addition. And the last but not least is every company that is founded in St. Mary's County is identified very clearly in this book. And of course, that's most of the companies here. So the strength of our technology community is really deep and broad, and this certainly is a testament to that fact. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about the cover. Each year we have a cover contest that the Patuxent Partnership manages for us. This year it is the highest cash prize, and each year we have a wonderful inflow of designs that the Patuxent Partnership juries, but it's always exciting for a student in our county to be the winner. And this year, Hannah Chowski, who's here, is the winner of our design contest, and I'd like Gene Townsend with the Patuxent Partnership to talk a little bit about the contest and award.
Yeah, we voted on it by our board members, our employees, and it was done with the secret ballot, and so this was voted the best handbook cover, so it was very nice. And I think it was pretty far the highest number by a large amount, so it wasn't close.
Want to give her the check, okay. I'm sure she'd be thrilled.
Hannah, on behalf of the Patuxent Partnership, I'd like to present this $10,000 check to you.
We certainly want to recognize the guests who are here with Hannah to enjoy this moment, Nora Blasco, mm-hmm. her mother, Janetta and Steve Richkowski, her father Steve and his wife Janetta, and Paige Casey, who is the teacher at the James Forrest Technology Career Center, where Hannah takes her classes. So Hannah, can you talk a little bit about, you know, perhaps some of your career goals or being involved in this? Is this the first contest you've entered, or?
It's not, because we do a lot of projects in my graphics class, and so I guess I want to thank Ms. Page for always helping us to get that stuff done and be involved, and we do a lot of community stuff.
Thank you. Well, it certainly made a difference for us. Parents or anything, would you like to say anything? Proud of your daughter, I'm sure.
Very proud of her, and she's going to continue in the art field with a graphic design degree, hopefully at Salisbury in 4 years, where she got accepted. So
Fantastic. Well, of course, you can enter the contest in future years too, even if you're at Salisbury. So, yeah. So we want to thank you very much. And anybody else, or commissioners?
And I'd like to say something real quick. It's just so you understand. Mr. Castellino's talked about that being a great tool. That is a great handbook that doesn't just end up in the hands of people in Maryland. It is all over the country, and sometimes it leaves the country. So you're going to get quite the following there because people are interested in who put that together. So congratulations. That's a big accomplishment.
And you did a great job. Excellent. It's very, very good cover, and it's going to be on the cover for a couple of years now. It's going to go on, so you'll get a lot of exposure on that. So continue with your artwork there. You did a great job.
Thank you very much, commissioners, and perhaps
you want to
assemble
for
the picture.
We want to gather, to get a little better picture out here. So if everybody would just come on to the front here and line up across here, one more picture for our record, you might say. Squeeze on in.
Sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Good. Really good version of the installment.
Thank you for this. Give Tony a couple minutes to straighten up. Okay, we'd like to continue on with our county administrator time.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. First on your agenda this morning, Commissioners, is to review the draft meeting agendas for March 1st and March 8th. On March 1st, you have two proclamations scheduled. Tentatively scheduled is the Financial Literacy Month and Developmental Disabilities Awareness Month. Also, you have tentatively scheduled at 10 a.m. a law enforcement compensation study presentation by the consultants. Then that wraps up your morning meeting on March 1st. You have an afternoon budget work session beginning at 1:30 p.m. And then at 6 o'clock p.m., you have tentatively scheduled your public hearing on amendments to the code of St. Mary's County. The following week on March 8th, you have your morning session begins with the commissioners of St. Mary's County sitting as the St. Mary's County Board of Health. And then you also have tentatively scheduled an executive session on real property acquisition, which we'll add to your agenda. That afternoon is 1:30 p.m., a budget work session, and then 6:30 p.m. is your public forum that's held here in the Chesapeake Building. So for this morning's business meeting, we begin with item B, the Department of Aging and Human Services modification of FY16 General Block Treatment Grant Services and Administration. Presenting this morning is Lori Jennings-Harris, Director, Cynthia Brown, Manager, Division of Human Services, and Mary Ellen Kreese, Treatment and Prevention Coordinator. In the audience, in case you have questions, are Gary Lynch from Walden Sierra, Mary Logstrom, Executive Director of Jude House, and Pete Cucinato, the Drug Court Coordinator. Thank you, Ms. Harris.
Morning, ladies.
Good morning, Commissioners. So this first agenda item for your review and approval or consideration are several actions are related to drug court. The first is to terminate the subrecipient agreement with Step Into Recovery effective February 29th of this year for outpatient treatment services related to drug court. The second is to amend the subrecipient agreement with the Jude House to increase the agreement amount by $28,498. To include outpatient treatment services along with the inpatient services that they are currently providing for drug court participants. And then finally, to amend the subrecipient agreement with Walden to decrease the residential funding by $10,000. Ms. Kreese and Ms. Brown are here to answer any questions you may have.
Tell me about Step Into Recovery. In the short time we've been sitting up here, there was a group before them. Then there was them, now we're going to another group. Is that something that's hard to keep? I guess I've seen a lot of changes, and this be a third one seemed like a year or so.
Right. Well, since I came on board at the end of last May, Step Into Recovery had been the current provider of outpatient services for drug court. They apparently were having some issues maintaining staff to come down to this area. I guess they are based out of more central or outside of Baltimore area. Okay. So they do have some another office in Calvert County. So apparently they were having difficulty with maintaining staff down here in this area. So
how much work were you giving? How many cases were you referring to?
There's 30 slots for adults and 20 slots for adolescents in the drug court program, so about 50.
Full. The slots are all full?
Pretty much, yeah. Okay. They stay pretty busy.
Okay. All right.
On following Commissioner Hewitt, where is Jude House?
The Jude House is based in Charles County as a residential program, so currently they have funds from this grant mm-hmm. to pay for inpatient services. The drug court coordinator approached me and asked about utilizing them in the outpatient capacity. So they are expanding in St. Mary's County to be able to provide the same clients, basically, the services for outpatients. So there is a consistency there.
But they're in Charles, as you said.
Correct.
Okay.
They're based out of Charles.
What is, I guess I've watched this now for 6 years, as Commissioner Hewitt points out, you know, we keep bouncing back and forth. Can you tell us what Walden's doing wrong that you keep bouncing around and finding other sources besides Walden, who is the St. Mary's County organization and headquartered here?
I personally am not the one who made the decision. So I was approached by the drug court team or coordinator, and in conjunction with the drug court judge, they made a decision that they wanted to make that change. So I guess it's unfortunate that the first provider outlook that was they were utilizing, I'm not quite sure what happened there because that was before my time, but the Jude House is someone they decided to, I guess, offer another option to drug court clients, and then they're basically reducing inpatient money. So that's where they've decided they like the inpatient services that Jude House is providing, and they wanted to expand, you know, the funding to provide that as a service.
With that premise, then one would assume then Walden does not have the capacity to handle the drug court cases if we have to outsource to Charles County.
I don't believe for the inpatient that's the case. They actually offer a different level of care. So they offer a 3.3 and 3.5. It's an intermediate level of care, where Walden offers a low intensity 3.1 and then the detox. So basically, if you looked at it, it really covers the spectrum of inpatient care between the two providers. And then it offers a choice for the drug court clients.
Is Jude accredited, nationally accredited?
They are in the process. There's a mandate by the state to become accredited. So basically all the providers in the state had to apply for accreditation. So they are in the process of that.
So we have Walden and St. Mary's, who's nationally accredited, and we're going to move people to Charles to somebody waiting on accreditation.
Well, they already are an inpatient provider. So basically they wanted to add additional money to be able to, so that's where the funding's being moved from Walden to Jude House.
I guess my concern at the end of the day is that, you know, I was sat on the drug court before I was elected, so I have some premise of how the drug court operates. The state sends money to each of the counties to provide services for rehabilitation and whatever, mm-hmm. and we have Walden in the county. So money comes from the state to each of the counties across the board. And it arrives in St. Mary's to take care of our clientele. So what you come back and say now is, oh, by the way, because something else is going on, we want to take $10,000 or so of money that's been allocated to St. Mary's County for drug rehabilitation and move it up to Charles for drug rehabilitation services. And then I'm assuming along the way, because this has to be monitored, somebody has to go up to Charles County to Jude House to see what's going on to make sure that they're doing what Walden is already doing in the local area.
Well, actually, there's Charles County does not have, well, that's their only inpatient provider. St. Mary's has Walden. And as I said, the spectrum of services are different at the Jude House. So some of the other providers in other counties actually utilize facilities all over the state. It just depends. It gives the client a choice. So it's not a bad thing to offer a client a choice. And, you know, different providers, sometimes they feel like they need to be out of the area because they're too close to home and some of the connections, the drug connections. And they, so I don't think it's necessarily, you know, a bad thing to expand to other Southern Maryland facilities.
Commissioner Morgan, Mr. Cuccinelli is in the audience and he was part of the decision to move the money. Perhaps he'd like to speak.
Sure, thank you.
I'm glad to address it. We're talking about, Commissioner, good morning. Two separate issues.
Please go ahead and get the microphone right there. Please identify yourself and speak, please.
I'm Pete Cuccinato, the drug court coordinator for both the adult and juvenile. So just historically, the stream of money that Commissioner Morgan brought up has been divided two ways. One has been to support a vendor to be our team member who puts time in over and above their treatment services to come to our court hearings, come to our team meetings, put things into our information system, things that they don't get reimbursed for normally. Historically, Walden's here was our partner in that for many years. They chose to step away from us. So we had to go out and seek another provider for that. That wasn't our choice, Commissioner Morgan. That was Walden's here's choice. We brought in Outlook Recovery Services last year, a year and a half ago. They chose, once they got in and got set up, decided they were just going to do methadone maintenance and not traditional outpatient treatment. They were a good partner, but they decided to take a different route, which Step Into Recovery came into the process and brought us here where we are today, and you've heard an update on Step Into. So that's that one funding flow. So I just want to make that clear. That was never our choice to part ways with Walden Sierra being our team partner in that stream of money. That was their choice, and that's fine. We've adjusted that nicely. Then we do have that other stream of money that came in as part of this lump sum that was always traditionally set aside for residential services. And as you've heard today from Ms. Crace, very eloquently, I think, there's different levels of care. And we have always wanted to have the most opportunity for our clients to be able to address their needs by the appropriate levels of care. And Jude House offered us several levels of care that wasn't offered through the Anchor program. So we were fully supportive, myself and Judge Abrams, allowing our adult clients to have that choice in what met their needs the best, which in the treatment field, that's what you want to do. The client should have options on where to go and what meets their needs more appropriately. So that's where the residential differences come in.
Mr. Kuchin, I want to say this is, since I've been in this chair, it seems there's something going on with Walden and this drug court. And I don't know what it is, and I'm not here to ask you. But I'm here to tell you, if you had Walden for years, and now you've gone through three providers in about 13 months, makes me think, you guys doing your homework over there?
We're doing the best we can. Yeah, Commissioner, you got to understand, there wasn't a lot of vendors or providers in this county other than Walden Sierra, quite frankly. So there wasn't a lot that we could go out and seek on our own once we needed to find another partner. Walden Sierra was pretty much the health department for St. Mary's County for many, many years. So there wasn't a lot of vendors cultivating services down here in St. Mary's County. So we had to start from scratch, quite frankly.
We had to go out and seek vendors to come in
on our behalf.
I'm talking about process. Mm-hmm. I agree with Commissioner Morgan, taking this money and moving it up to Charles County, and under the idea it's going to get people out of their normal environment. My sense is, you know, it's not that easy for people to drive up there. I guess if they have to get there, they get there. In county, with this money, I think is a better idea. So is there somebody from Walden here that can tell us maybe their side of that?
Well, let me just clarify one thing. If you're talking about the outpatient services, Jude House is setting up here in St. Mary's County. Those clients will not be going to Charles County for those services.
So they'll be
they're getting Leonardtown? They're getting facilities here in Leonardtown as we speak. So they're going to have their offices here.
Right. Well, that,
so they're not going out of county for that. I just want to make that clear, if that was the contention.
The other part about being accredited versus non-accredited. And, you know, during the campaign, which has been a while now, I made time to go up there and view that facility. And it looked like they had potential for the beds. The part about 3.1, 3.5, these numbers you're throwing out, they seem like a pretty squared away bunch up there. And it seemed like they could get 3.5 if that was something. So
I can't honestly speak as to what level of service any provider wants to have or not have. They would have to speak on that, on their behalf on that.
I'm back to my original point. These people seem to have done it for years. For some reason unknown to me, they walked away for some reason. Now you've been stuck, you have three different providers in the last 13 months. So that just doesn't bode well with me.
Well, we're not happy with that either, believe me.
Commissioner Hewitt, Mr. Gary Lynch is here from Walden.
Well, I mean,
if you'd like to come forward.
Mr. Commissioner President thinks.
I just don't want to turn this into a lobbying portion for who should get what money and how they should get it and where they should explain their point of view. I think the drug court has done their research, and that's something that should probably be handled offline, since the other representatives, you know, we could probably be here all day with them going back and forth on it.
And my only interest is that we have the services done in St. Mary's County. or somehow, because I'm sure a lot of these customers you have right now don't really have the transportation to drive to Charles County or Calvert County or Prince George or wherever. But we don't have the services to provide. Maybe we do, I don't know. But right now, I'd like to see it concentrated in this area. But if you say this Jude House getting ready to build here in St. Mary's, I'm sort of satisfied with that.
Okay. So we do not want to hear from Mr. Lynch, correct?
Okay.
You do not want to hear from Mr. Lynch?
Mr. Lynch, okay, we got a couple more minutes, sure. Mr. Lynch, you want to come forward and address this issue?
Thank you. My name is Gary Lynch. I'm the CEO of Walden. I want to be clear. The residential services will be provided in Charles County. Jude House is locating an outpatient center. They can correct me if I'm wrong. And I want to say this, too. The drug court took about $10,000 of federal money to train Walden staff in working with adolescents. I think Jude House, I'm not sure they've ever worked with adolescents. I think that's a valid question for the commissioner. So I don't want to go on, but there's a lot of reasons. I have concerns clinically. I agree with Commissioner Connor. I don't want to go into that now, but I could go on for a lot of time about those concerns. So it's really considerations. And we can serve a lot of levels of care at our center. We've actually created transitional sober housing at California. We've created partial hospitalization day programs. People can go to work. They can live in the county. They can actually live in California. We have a new center with 20 beds there. So I just wanted to point that out. I thank you for your time. Unless there are any questions.
Are you able to service all these levels that you're all talking
about?
We
could do that. Really, levels of care are designed around specific problems. But generally speaking, if you're in the drug court, you should be going out and getting employment. Our program houses you. It gives you employment. It gives you programs during the day. We can actually expand that. That's my consideration, to be honest. And we are nationally accredited. We've been that for 12 years. It's really a nuance of what levels of care we want to have. The irony is we have Charles County Family Recovery Court sending us their people. We just got a prestigious federal probation contract for Charles County to serve their people. We just diverted 10 pretrial people from the detention center in January alone, saved the county about $130,000. So we're constantly doing innovative programming, a Vivitrol project. The governor's office contacted the sheriff last night. I know they're coming down because they're excited about new projects. So we're constantly looking for innovative ways to serve people. So.
Well, since you're up here, one of the questions now, and so you not only do you handle this, but you also handle emergency services through public safety, law enforcement for crisis intervention, correct?
Yes, we do. We have 250 calls a year through the sheriff's department. Something I'll add too: we have a program that's open on the weekends. We have family nights two nights a week. Our people can go to Lexington Park. We're open on the weekends. We have a good relationship with community policing. If there's a problem, they'll bring that client to us. If it's public intoxication, we'll try to get them into our center right away. We've really worked with a lot of programs, DSS, Office on Aging, to do those things.
The reason I bring that up is from the point the drug court's making is and one of the things I do understand in their total decision here is capacity issues. Because as I do understand it, a lot of times there is issues getting people in the first place for the capacity issues. There's been law enforcement personnel that have had to wait hours, days. They've had to go to different facilities outside of the county just because you're full in the first place.
Right.
So one of the things I'm looking at here, since the other people here on behalf of the drug court, is just that the capacity of Walden to handle the full services that are required just is not there.
Well,
whether it's funding, beds, facilities, however it may be. So that might be one of the things that they're keeping in mind when they're looking at how they're diversifying their services, because you are, you know,
right,
contracted out to so many different places and there is such a demand for beds.
Let me just say bluntly, there is no capacity issue with contract beds. We have grant beds, we have a certain pot, we have contract beds just like any other contractor. You purchase that bed, you get people in quickly. And let me give you a perspective. Since, I believe, May of last year, we've had about 5 drug court referrals, maybe some more. So it's not like you're talking a great number of clients coming in. In fact, that's another thing to consider. How many clients are you signing to go to Jude House? So you're creating a whole infrastructure. How many clients are actually going to be served? Those are questions that I really think, and again, I would look at if I were funding. I'm not saying anything about the program being not a good program, but I'm saying from a logistics perspective, what are you buying, how many beds are you buying, and what kind of infrastructure are you setting up? Those would be my considerations.
Any other questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. President, then, could we move the motions individually and vote on them, please?
Everybody agree? You want to go individual motions?
Yes.
Okay.
First motion, then, sir. I move to approve the termination of the subrecipient agreement between the Commissioners of St. Mary's County and Step Into Recovery LLC effective February 29, 2016.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So moved.
Second, an amended subrecipient agreement with the Jude House Inc. to increase the award by $28,498 for outpatient and inpatient services for drug court clients from the Behavioral Health Administration General Treatment Block Grant Project Number MD-1697.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Ayes have it.
An amendment subrecipient agreement between the county and Walden Sierra to decrease residential funding by $10,000 and authorize the commissioner present to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Nay.
It's like nays have it. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you, Commissioners. Item C is also Aging and Human Services, FY16 Medicare Improvements for Patients and Providers Act application. Joining Ms. Jennings Harris at the table is Debbie Barker, Senior INA Manager, and Peggy Mayo, Fiscal Supervisor. Good morning.
Good morning. So, Commissioners, the acronym is MIPA, for Medicare Improvements for Patients and Providers Act, and this is a grant application that we've gotten for a number of years from the Maryland Department of Aging in the amount of $7,160, and these funds are used for outreach efforts and enrollment of consumers in Medicare savings programs. Debbie Barker is the division manager, and she can answer any questions you have.
Questions, anyone?
Yep. Good job.
Yep.
You got a easy.
It's good to know.
Good news, girls.
I move to approve the Medicare Improvements for Patients and Providers Act, MIPPA, application project number US-1613 from the Maryland Department of Aging on behalf of the Department of Aging and Human Services in the amount of $7,160 and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related document.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have.
Thank you.
And item D, Commissioners, is from the Department of Public Works and Transportation, the airport road donation to State Highway Administration. Presenter this morning is George Erickson, Director. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, George.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'd like to acknowledge Sean Day, the Director of Engineering for Stanley Martin, who's in the audience, if you have any specific questions. Also, Joe Densford, who's the developer's representative for Wildwood Residential LLC. Very quickly, this is just an administrative item. As a part of the development of the Wildwood PUD, the developer was required to make certain improvements, and it's being done over multiple phases. One of those improvements has to do with improvements along Maryland 235 at the intersection of Airport Road and Maryland 235. State Highway Administration has asked, because they like to truncate their right-of-ways, for us to dedicate to them, quick claim to them, a portion of Airport Road right away, which we've been more than happy to do so that they can maintain the rest of the intersection. But the developer has sent a petition to us asking for your concurrence to transfer a portion of the property to the state. That requires a public hearing. We included in your packages a copy of the deed and quick claim and the plat that we would take forward if we went to public hearing. So we're requesting your concurrence in scheduling the public hearing. We wanted to give you the documents that you would have in front of you for that hearing. We don't think there's going to be any contention. It obviously comes with our support because it's one less thing we have to maintain. It satisfies the requirement made by State Highway on the developer as well. So with that brief introduction, if you have any questions, there's also an informational memorandum in your packages that describes this in a little bit more detail. It's only about 0.045 acres, a very small piece of right-of-way.
This is the piece, if I'm coming south on 230, if I'm going to make my right, where the Duke Airport sign is right now?
It is on the north side of the intersection, yes, sir.
Yeah, so, so if I'm coming south, that's where I make my right-hand turn.
It's when you make the right-hand turn, yes, sir.
So we can do this simply, or we're going to have a public hearing?
A public hearing is required, yes, sir.
By law?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll make sure. Just making sure we're not adding steps to the process to spend more time here.
No, absolutely not. Okay. It's
Now, is any construction going to actually happen, or are we just going to give them land?
Land right now, the first phase, southbound, a portion of the southbound lane for Wildwood Boulevard, that construction is complete. Phase two was a southbound lane in front of Wildwood Shopping Center. That's permitted, right, and construction is getting ready to happen. And there's a phase three, which is southbound 235 north of Airport Road, including a northbound turn lane into Airport Road. That's been permitted but not built. And the last phase, phase four, is northbound on 235 from Lenny's Restaurant to just north of Myrtle Dean Road. That portion of the improvements is under review by state but not yet permitted.
But again, the improvements we're talking about is just widening the
widening the intersection and truncating off the right of way.
What does truncating mean?
If you have a shape, I just have to draw it in the air if you don't mind. If you have two radii, okay, an entrance that looks like this, right of ways can either follow that radius or go from the two radius points in. So you truncate the right of way.
It sounds like an engineering thing, but it sounds like it's
going to
be
good. It's not my term.
The point is, it's going to be good, right?
Yes,
it's
sir.
A good
yes,
thing.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Just making it a little easier to turn rather than 90. It's going
to
be
a little bit easier to turn, but it provides them additional right of way, which
easier
is just
flow.
It's part of their standard practice. Some of the right of way.
It'll widen the roadway coming into Airport Road plus make it easier.
That's correct, but some of the right-of-way has nothing to do with constructing improvements. It just has to do with their standard practice of giving them enough room at the intersection so that if they do have to do additional work or maintenance, that they have that room.
I can hardly wait till MDE gets into where that little area is for the water in there. We're going to find all kinds of toads. And
Don't start anything now. Well, Commissioner President, I'd like to move to authorize staff to schedule a public hearing for the conveyance of the county's interest in a portion of Airport Road, County Route 30466, as shown on the donation plat and described in the quit claim deed.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you. We'll look at your schedule and try to get that on as soon as we can.
Mr. President, before we move on, I just have a request for Dr. Bridget on item B that we voted down for the $10,000 to Walden Sierra. Seeing how the project now is increased by $10,000 from the $28,000 because it was going to balance out, what I would like from the Department of Emergency Services, the Sheriff's Office, and also Calvert and Charles is all the statistics from them as to how many times they've tried to go to Walden Sierra and been denied beds in the last 2 years, as well as the I'd like to see if we can't get something from our local public safety as to an opinion of dealing with Walden Sierra when trying to get into Usabed. It can be as simple as an email return survey. I just want to confirm what I already have from the public safety personnel in general.
Mr. O'Connor, I think that's an interesting statistic, but concerned about comparing the drug courts versus people being brought in by Sheriff's Department personnel. They're two different things.
It's one and the same because when he was up here, there was nobody from Jude House to go ahead and defend themselves. And the issue is that we're giving them an extra $10,000 to provide these beds, and we're increasing $10,000 of taxpayer money, which it would have equaled out in the $28,000. So now we're also funding those beds for the Sheriff's Office, which are going to take beds away from the people on the funding that we're giving to the Sheriff's Office by increasing the funding there. They've also had multiple other contracts. So it all ties together how it's working. And this is everything that the drug court keeps in mind when they're making these decisions. So just the fact that we're allocating an additional $10,000 or not taking it away, I just like to have the statistics to back up everything as a big picture, just because Jude and the drug court didn't have everything here to present it. That's what I'd like to see.
Okay. So just for the record, for the audience, because for the public, because you can't see the audience, we did have two representatives from Jude House here.
I didn't see them.
They just didn't see
them. Okay. All right. I did not see them. I'm sorry about that. Yeah. I did not see them.
And the other question to ask is, as we go down a road of fiscal conservancy, how much is it going to cost all these guys to spend time to come up with the statistics over, I bet you it'll cost more than $10,000 to get the statistics than it's the $10,000 we voted down.
Absolutely not. I bet you it's a CAD report or it's a simple email. So I highly doubt it would cost more than $10,000.
No more than that. you'll try to get some of those figured if possible. Yeah.
I think it'll also help us during budget cycle when we're looking at their requests.
If that's something the commissioners would like me to attempt to obtain.
I mean, if not, I mean, I can get it on my own. I mean, it's no.
I think it's apples and oranges. I think it's an interesting statistic, but I don't think it solves the $10,000 in this particular. That's my opinion. But
I mean, I can go with it. For this commission, I'd say yes, go do it, because unless you run against something that's really onerous and really hard or whatever, you know. But if it's just
I'm not going to spend the thousands of dollars trying to
Survey.
Okay, let me see what I can find.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay.
And for item E is Department of Public Works and Transportation, Buck Hewitt Road, Phase 4, purchasing of real property. Mr. Erickson.
This might seem like an extra step, Commissioner Morgan, and we talked about the law, but this is also the law. In order, the Annotated Code of Maryland and the Open Meeting Act specifically talks about real property purchases, and any decision by the county commissioners to decide to purchase real property requires a couple of things. One, for that decision to be made in an open public session, but that there be a notice also posted. We know you support this project. We know you're interested to know and find out that the design's done and the plats and things that we need to do to acquire the property are all done. We're ready to go. But the other piece to that is, in order to do that, we have to acquire the property, which requires your concurrence. With that concurrence comes a 15-day posting, which has to happen prior to your decision, if you choose to decide today, which has been posted. A copy of that notice is provided in your packages. The good news about this particular project is we've done the appraisals already as well. So you know the value of these takings is roughly about $82,000. Good news about that, more good news, is that this project is eligible for 80% funding because it is a state aid project. We got this project included in the state aid program several years ago. So 80% of any money that we spend on this project is reimbursable by the state. One bad piece of news, State Highway is not here to help us do property acquisition, so we'll just have to do what we used to do when I was on the engineering side here several years ago. We just do letters and knock on doors, just do it the old school way. We just won't be paying someone to do that. We'll use our project manager on this project to go do that. We'll bring those offers back to you. We'll get your concurrence on those purchases as those happen along the way, and we'll try to bundle them up so that we don't have things on your agenda every week. We'll try to bundle them up into packages. There's only 13 properties affected, so hopefully we can bring five or six of them back at a time.
Okay, here's a question you used to. When's someone going to be able to drive from Chances Run Road to Peg Road?
On Buck Hewitt Road?
FDO Boulevard.
That's a separate question.
That's his favorite question.
This is all tied up into it.
No,
we talk about 5 years.
Separate issue. We can talk about that this afternoon. No, but to answer your question, phase 1A, as you know, has been awarded. Mm-hmm. We came before you to have that awarded. Phase 2, the solicitation documents are with procurement right now, and we're bringing the MOU that we need with Metcom because it's a joint solicitation to you on March 1st. When you sign those, the bid documents for phase 1B will be released. Phase 1C, the design is almost completed and pending our wetland permit, which I could tell you about that this afternoon. Pending on our wetland permit, phase 1C is intended to follow soon after that. The good news, and I'm full of good news today, I know, each part is very much independent, so we hope to have contractor overlap. It won't be contractor conflict. 1A is on one side of the project, can be done completely independently of 1B. 1C, same thing. So even though each phase is to take 12 months, we hope that there's overlap so that the 3-year period, 12 times 3, is more like 2 years. So I'm being consistent with my response with 2 years, and I'm sticking to it until the wetland permit becomes an issue.
Okay, and so that's your story and you're sticking to it.
Absolutely.
Good one. I like that story.
I could have just said 2 years, I guess. And
no, I like it.
Saved you some time.
And Mr. Erickson also has item F in the department to... I'm sorry. Yeah, you should.
Mr. President, I move to approve the acquisition of real property and easements required for the Buck Hewitt Road Phase 4, project number HW1103.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any nays? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners. And now on item F is the Department of Public Works and Transportation, Ellis Road Revetment, Department to Natural Resources Shoreline Conservation Service Project Agreement. Mr. Erickson.
Commissioners, we've been before you before on this project, in fact, a couple of times. It's a $360,000 project. We've attached the capital improvement program budget sheet, which describes the project. It's basically 525 feet of shoreline protection along Ellis Road, which is along St. Clements Bay. The project was also identified in the county's hazard mitigation plan. That's why we've been trying to pursue MEMA and FEMA funding. There are two funding alternatives for this project. The first one is a DNR 0% loan for the entire value of the project. The second one is a MEMA FEMA project, 75% funded by the state, 25% county match. The 25% county match, we can use the DNR 0% interest loan. Oh, wow. So it's in our best interest to pursue the 75-25 because it's only 25% of a 0% loan instead of 100%. Having said that, MEMA sent a request up to FEMA to get the project approved for funding. FEMA denied the request.
Oh, bummer.
Back in December, we submitted a consent letter to the commissioners to send to our Southern Maryland delegation and congressmen to ask them to help us help them reconsider the project for funding. We have not heard back yet. DNR contacted us on February 3rd and said, we've got this 100% 0% interest loan.
What do you want to do?
You're going to lose the money if you don't sign this agreement now. But there's a caveat to that that says if your appeal goes forward and you only need 25% of that money, not 100%, just let us know. So they're not going to penalize us if we don't use 100% of the funding. But I'm here to also tell you we're not just going to move forward with the project even though we know it's funded under this agreement. We want to make sure we hear back from this appeal so that we expend the least amount of our own money as possible.
When do you expect to do the project?
Whenever we get it designed and whenever we get the funding approval. The key is getting the funding in place. The design only takes probably 4 months, and then it's got to be permitted, and that can be 6 months. If you're lucky, it's 6 months. This project, I don't think, is going to be one of those 12-month specials, but you know, 6 to 12 months is very common. So with the design first and then the construction, you're looking at a year and a half, easy, before we can actually get this done. So DNR is working closely with us. The agreement doesn't have a caveat in it that says, and oh, by the way, if you don't move forward, their concern is that we won't have any funding, whether it's 25% or 100, if we don't get this agreement signed. We've had this since last summer. They know that we've been holding on to it. And they finally said, you know, it's February, let's secure the funding. And we're here to tell you we think that's a good idea. And we're still waiting to hear from the appeal, though, as well.
Any other questions?
Move to approve and authorize Commissioner President to execute the State of Maryland Department of Natural Resources Shoreline Conservation Service Project Agreement for the Ellis Road Revetment Project.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Okay, Commissioners, item G is from the Department of Recreation and Parks to present an amendment number 18 to multi-year encroachment protection agreement. Brian Lowy, Director, Department of Recreation and Parks, and Chris Castellamus, Director, Department of Economic Development, presenting. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
As Dr. Bridget stated, we're here to present amendment number 18 to the multi-year encroachment protection agreement. Navy contract number N62470-09-00018 to the Commissioner of St. Mary's County for consideration and approval. This amendment will expand the area of interest and allow for a Navy readiness and environmental protection integration, which is REPI funding, for acquisition of real estate as noted in attachment B in your packet. The REPI boundary designates the area where Navy funding can be used for conservation purposes. The REPI program helps to prevent encroachment that can limit or restrict military operations. A key component of the REPI program is the use of partnerships among military conservation groups and state and local partnerships. These partnerships typically share the cost of land acquisition and easements. These REPI funds were used as part of the Shannon Farm property acquisition as well. The county first became a party to this multi-year encroachment protection agreement on September 29th of 2014, and in your packet it actually shows the attached area of expansion as part of St. Mary's It looks like an area east of 235 from approximately Maryland Route 4 up to Maryland Route 247. It also expands upon parts of Calvert County as well as some of the Eastern Shore.
Where's 247?
Loveville area, Route 5 to
Loveville Road.
Loveville Road connects over.
King Kennedy Estates, we make the left off 235.
That's the off of that road, yeah.
But that's 247.
That's a connector, yeah.
So they're expanding this whole area that they're looking to.
Yes, on your original map, attachment A had parts of the Eastern Shore as well as St. Mary's into Charles. And
you're referring to this one, right?
Yes. Yes.
And that hatch.
I had a little bit of a hard time figuring it out, but I'm sure you can help me. Okay.
We tried to show you a blow-up as well that deals with the rural legacy areas, and this is not affecting the Huntersville rural legacy area at all.
Okay.
Any other questions? I just throw in there the REPI money has been very helpful to the county in establishing the rural legacy areas. I would say that, for one thing, the federal budget does have is REPI money, and there's a lot of it for the Washington region. And I think we, for the governor coming down this weekend, we should maybe encourage, you know, the use of more open space money so we can get those matching federal dollars for St. Mary's County. Otherwise, we're going over across the bay, where for some reason they come up with a lot of, you know, land trust money and things like that, the REPI dollars can match. The question you had, Commissioner, 247, the reason that becomes valuable is that's one of the big helicopter patterns the county or the base uses. So that's why they're trying to preserve that stuff up there for, just, you know. So the sidelight is that a lot of REPI money, good for the county. We just need to get more open space dollars to help, you know, balance those dollars out in the county side.
See, my confusion was, I remember it wasn't long ago, even though probably 6 months, we had people come in and talk about this Huntersville area and this Mattapony area. You know, I've been, I lived in this place like 55 years, never heard of Huntersville, but that's not unusual, you know. But I was confused as to why those were more important than, say, other places, whether it be, you know, the 7th District or something like that. Why? Is it all about the landing patterns of the airplanes?
It's the flight patterns, not the landing patterns. Yeah. Okay. Helicopters go north and jets go south. That's the easiest way for a layman to explain it.
Okay. Good.
Then, Mr. President, I move to approve the Commissioner President to execute Amendment 18 to the Multi-Year Encroachment Protection Agreement, Navy Contract Number N62470-09-Romeo-Paul-00018. To expand the area of interest to allow for Navy funding for acquisition of real estate.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And item H is from the Department of Emergency Services and Technology for acceptance of the Valley Lee Lease Agreement. Mr. Bob Kelly, Director, Emergency Services and Technology, presenting. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Bob.
Before you this morning to present the tower lease agreement, proposed tower lease agreement between St. Mary's County and Selco, which is actually Verizon, a subsidiary of Verizon. This would allow Verizon to install some commercial cell phone equipment at our Valley Lee Tower, the Valley Lee Convenience Center. Some background information, Commissioners, and for the public. The county released a request for expression of interest. It was issued on December 28th and closed on January 28th, asking any other telco providers if they were interested in this space that's available on the tower. There were no other providers that responded. The agreement before you is for Verizon to install communications equipment on the tower. They'll pay us $24,000 a year, the first period of 5 years with a 4 years extension, so it's a 25-year agreement. Some other information, some other background information for you, Commissioners, that we required Verizon to perform a structural and intermod interference analysis for the tower. We found that there was plenty of capacity on the tower, even with this equipment. In addition to the state of Maryland has expressed some interest in putting some equipment on the tower, so we had Verizon include those expansion possibilities in the future. So if the state does, if that does come about, the state will not have to do that in an intermod study or a structural analysis. Of course, we would bring that agreement before you for approval also. The dollar amount in this lease is consistent with the dollar amount that we have for the leasing, what we're leasing from Verizon at the Hollywood Hollywood Tower, so that's kind of a good offset, so it's the same amount of money there. And the final note would be, I would just mention that this would make a lot of people in the Valley area very happy that they have.
Yeah, I've gotten a lot of calls lately from Valley saying that tower's been up over a year, I suppose, and their phone service has not changed.
So they weren't calling you from Valley Lee. They're calling you from.
I wouldn't recall it from. I don't know. I said.
I think they're yelling.
They're assuming that tower went up to put in Verizon services, and I said, "Well, I don't think the Verizon services are on that tower yet." And
most of the folks and most of the calls that I get is actually for a tower that's installed further down, closer to the Stewart Petroleum area. And again, we really don't control where the commercial telcos locate and what towers they choose to locate on. But Verizon did approach us. They're very, very interested in going almost 200 feet on our existing tower.
Okay.
So for the folks in my district that will be benefiting from this, any idea how long it will take before it's operable?
Quite frankly, they're very excited, and they want to move very, very quickly. So it's probably within less than 3 months, I would guess, that they would be.
Better than 2 years.
Damn, that'd be great.
Well, let's not delay this anymore. I move to approve and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the tower lease agreement.
Second.
Any more discussion?
Yes, discussion. I just want to know, I know Commissioner Jarbo had a chance to meet with Ridge. So
I was just going to ask Mr. Kelly to stay behind.
Yeah, well, I was going to see if we could just, I don't know if it's two separate issues, procedurally speaking. He was able to get to the bottom of it.
Let's go with this.
As soon as we get to Commissioner Time, if he was remain behind, you'll.
Yes, sir. We'd love
Thank
it.
You.
Yeah. We have a first and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Ayes have it. John, you got it.
Yeah, I was going to see if, since Commissioner Jarbo was able to get to the bottom of the resolution with Ridge, since it was already presented publicly and Mr. Kelly has the agreement, so we wouldn't delay that any further, if we could just have the motion to execute the document that Mr. Kelly has in hand or whatever facts Commissioner Jarbo has, so he can just move forward with that.
Procedurally, I'll leave it to Dr. Bridget to answer that question.
I think we got on next month's.
Next week. Have it procedurally on March. If you'd like me to pull up the draft motion,
I have it here.
Or do you have it? Okay, thank you.
We'll do it. I'll give you some background first.
Go ahead and move it forward in the
day.
That's okay with everybody. Is that all right? Okay.
So, background for the public and also for Mr. Kelly. We did have a great meeting last night. Down in Ridge at the firehouse, we had representatives from the Ridge Fire Department and also from the rescue squad. It came out, and the conversation was, of course, on putting the tower up in that area of the county. Main concern they wanted to bring up is that they want to expedite the positioning of the tower as soon as possible. Both parties were very pleased with the site on the carnival grounds and asked me to replay up to the commissioners that they want to move forward with that site. So there's no other discussion. So at this time, I move to approve the amendment to the lease agreement dated April 8th, 2014 between the county and the Ridge Volunteer Fire Department on behalf of Emergency Services and Technology and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those approved?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any nays? Ayes have it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioners. And this concludes County Administrator time.
Okay, we'll move right into commissioner's time. We'll start with Commissioner Morgan.
Thank you, Mr. President. This week I had the opportunity to go to the Mechanicsville Rescue Squad dinner with Commissioner Hewitt. Good time was had by all, and I want to congratulate all the people up there that worked so hard at the north end of the county. Earlier in the week, I had an opportunity to drive to Mount Airy so I could witness the operation of a slaughterhouse. For a DOD contractor, learning about slaughtering pigs and cows was rather interesting. Fortunately, they weren't particularly slaughtering that day, but I think, as everybody knows, there's a great demand in this county and the Tri-County region to develop a slaughterhouse, a meat processing facility, a retail store, and a kitchen. And I learned a lot, and I'm happy to say that, you know, based on that visit, the Tri-County Council has placed a few more, a higher impetus on SMATIC to get the procurement moving so that the requirement that the farmers have asked so much for around here can be satisfied in the not-too-distant future. And I'll say that you're going through the state procurement process, so I'm not going to sit there and say it's going to happen overnight, but I want you to know that we did visit the slaughterhouse. We did learn a lot. We have a much better understanding of what SMEDIC should be pushing forward for, so we're moving ahead. So that's pretty much it. Thank you.
Unfortunately, I wasn't able to make the Mechanicsville Rescue Squad. My mother and father came down from New York. I don't get to see them as often as I would like, so I spent as much time as with them as I possibly could, and they headed back up to New York on Sunday. So sorry I couldn't be there, but as everybody knows, family has to come first and on those occasions, and I'm sure everybody there understands that. Just traffic in the north end, I did have some meetings about that. So we are coming to a resolution with some traffic pattern adjustments in the north end for the weekends. It looks like there'll be some diversions set up and some blocking of the roads, hopefully, with temporary type apparatuses, type jersey walls that'll be set up. They'll block the medians, hopefully, so people can't actually cut across Route 5. And that'll hopefully stop the traffic accidents that are happening when people are making the right-hand turns or cutting across and the right-angle collisions at the uncontrolled intersections. I'm working on some stuff at the airport to hopefully streamline some county services over there with permitting, some management areas as well. Talking to some members of the airport advisory committee and seeing what can be done there. I understand they had a really good meeting yesterday, so following up with that, and I'll be in touch with some of them as well. I would like to congratulate the Department of Economic Development. The UAS Technology County sign did make it into the first report that went up to the governor's office recently, and St. Mary's County was highlighted in there for everything that we're doing. And that would also makes me highlight one of our local companies, ASIC, who actually they did one of the drone or UAS demonstration for the county. Well, recently they had some meetings with the local government insurance trust, and Legit is actually rolling out their insurance policy for UAS technology for all of the their customers that they insure, St. Mary's County being one of them. Well, there's a lot of information that needs to be filled in for the risk management side. ASIC being one of the leading providers among other companies, but they are a St. Mary's County-based business, and they are actually working with Legit, and they are providing all the key information that they'll need for the risk management side, white papers, et cetera. And they're also presenting at all of the Legit workshops throughout the entire state of Maryland. So I think it's a great accomplishment that a St. Mary's County business that's working with UAS from a UAS technology county is presenting from the insurance company that insures mostly all of our local municipalities and our governments that are not self-insured in the state of Maryland. It's an outstanding accomplishment and just shows what happens when the government, you know, the public-private partnerships work together and what can happen. So congratulations to them, and best of luck with Legit and moving forward with these programs and getting that report up to the governor. Thank you.
So again, shout out to the First District Company 4 and Company 49. Thank you, Mr. Commissioner O'Connor, for interjecting, and we satisfied exactly what you asked me to do last night, which is to get that tower back on track as soon as possible. So as of this morning, we've done that, and so glad it was a good team effort among the commissioners, and special thanks to Bob Kelly and his team. This past week, I spent in Kiev, Ukraine. I was on a trade mission for private industry. I represented, while I was over there, four companies, one from Charles County, three from St. Mary's, including the one Commissioner O'Connor was just discussing. A lot of people wonder, why do you travel overseas? Why do you go to these other countries? Well, in the Ukraine right now, they're looking for a few things that I think might resonate: unmanned aviation systems, autonomous unmanned vehicles, and underwater sensor technology, all of which is being developed here in St. Mary's County with St. Mary's County business. This past year, the federal government deemed to send to the Ukraine $367 million of foreign military financing money. Why that's important is because foreign military financing money is your tax dollars at the federal level sent to other countries to buy U.S. technology. So the U.S. government is donating money to the country of Ukraine, but Ukraine is required then to spend that money on U.S. goods. And so my approach is, why should they spend it on anyone else's goods than St. Mary's County? So had a really good meeting. It was interesting, and I want to thank staff here for the commissioners for helping me out, because at the last minute they discovered I was also a politician. So the next thing I know, I was on a meeting with the governor of the Cherkasy district, Chukwenko, and he wanted to sign teaming agreements for economic development with St. Mary's County. I explained to him that I was in no position to do that because I'm just one of a five-person board. So he one-upped me and sent me back with an MOU to give to Governor Larry Hogan. And the team from the Ukraine Ministry of Defense and Ukroboroprom, which is their main state agency that develops all the weapon systems for the military, are coming to the United States sometime in mid-May. And they've asked for us to put a delegation up to meet with them in the Baltimore area. So, again, people ask me, why do you travel to these other countries? Why aren't you here paying attention to what's going on in St. Mary's County? Why are you doing this? Because I'm taking St. Mary's County forward. We need to look at opportunities that are out there. And clearly, we are the center of excellence for autonomy, and we should be out shining that light everywhere. And that's what I intend to do. So thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Mike? Commissioner Jarbo, good work. Hopefully that's some of that $367 million makes its way back here. So thank you for doing that. I, too, attended the Mechanicsville Rescue Squad, and like I told those people, we can't thank them enough. We can't give them enough plaques. We can't give them enough proclamations. What we can really say is thank you, and thank you for being there and taking times away from your family to help other people. Attended both the Eastmick-Seismic breakfast with Commissioner Morgan and the legislative breakfast held yesterday over at Old Brenton Inn. Reason I bring those two up is we're in budget season. And everybody knows budgets are always challenging. Everybody's trying to get their fair share of the pie. And Board of Ed has come forth with a big request. I've heard from a lot of people in the area that, you know, it seems unreasonable that they're asking for so much money, even though they haven't gotten more students. That needs a lot of thought, and it needs a lot of study. So I support education. We need to see what we can do. Secondly, state's attorney's office has asked for more money for salaries, maybe more positions. It's another meeting we're going to have to make sure that what we're doing there is, in fact, getting us to bang for the buck. I want to talk to them about helping out our sheriff's department and making sure these deputies who work midnight shifts and has to go in early next day for court are processed very quickly. So that's another discussion. Emergency services. We sat with some people who talked about, you know, we should look at their overtime budget and look at what they're doing to maybe make some kind of more efficiencies, is the term. But lastly, for the past several months, I've been very concerned about Metcom. And I've been very concerned because I think their rates are continually going up too high. Their hookup fees have grown dramatically. Well, I read that article in that Oracle we call the Enterprise, and it talked to 60% of people, 60% of their 17,000 customers have experienced a rate decrease. If that's true, that's excellent. I've heard from probably the 40%, because I have gotten a lot of emails, a lot of calls, a lot of people stopping me, and what I've asked them to do is blank out the names, blank out the addresses, but give me a copy of your bill. And let me do a comparison from a year ago or whatever comparison they think is a fair comparison. Because in April, we're going to have Metcom here. And we're going to talk to how can we keep rates down. Now, what's unique about this board, I think, is there's some commissioners here who want to diversify the economy, and that's excellent. That's a great idea. I'm totally behind that. There's other commissioners who want to lower the cost of living, not just for business people, but for everybody. And eliminating things like the energy tax, capping the constant yield, or holding the constant yield, and even maybe reducing the 5% to 4% on the homestead credit. That's going to help people, a lot of people, a lot more people than targeted taxing. But what we have to be careful of revenues. We need to make sure that what we do is fiscally responsible. And that's my goal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. Mine is very short and sweet. Yeah, we do have responsibility here with this budget process coming up. And we do have to balance our budget, and we got to be very careful about our revenues. And so I feel the same way about cutting taxes as much as possible for everybody if we can. But we have to look at this process very closely. Also, right now, there's a big, you might say, the legislators in session through mid-April. Myself and Jarbo going up tomorrow again. He's on the Land Use Committee. I'm on the Education Legislative Committee. And these are important functions that we do right out of the county here by sitting on these and looking at what bills that we can possibly push. MACO is an association for all the counties, but they help to, might say, testify and push through either we oppose or we support certain bills, or we have nothing whatsoever to do with them, but we try to make sure that everybody is given a fair share on these legislative bills. Sometimes it's very trying when you're dealing with some of these, but just a couple of weeks ago, we interjected on one bill where they were going to really oppose, and we got them to support and sort of turned it around as we both made comments to the MACO staff there that we needed to support the bill that gave some, as a matter of fact, it was to retirees, military retirees, an additional income modification for tax purposes. Not very much, but, you know, it's still something that helps in our total economic package, draw people here, keep people here. And these people come in and retire, and I have to tell you that they get six-digit incomes, buy big houses, and that's our two primary sources of income for our county. So we want them to stay here. We want them to come and buy. So that's some of the things. So some of the things we go up in MACO and do, it's not a wasted trip to go up there every Wednesday. I saw last year, I wasn't very much into it last year because I didn't understand the whole process, but now I've gotten a little better about it. We also go visit our senators and our legislators and sit down and talk to them at their little tables in their back room to discuss things that are important to our county. I'm interested in St. Mary's County more than anything else. And I'm not really discounting other counties, but that's what I'm after, whatever we can get here. And that's the main thing I want to go after. And we're going to be going tomorrow morning. It'll probably be an all-day affair again tomorrow. And there's several bills I'd probably like to go see and testify, possibly on one of them. I've been asked, not this week, next week. So we'll see what happens tomorrow on that.
Mr. Hewitt is also testifying tomorrow.
I'm not going to be with those guys, though. Don't worry.
No. Mr. Hewitt's going to have to drive his own. He's got to go separate.
He's part of the process.
So. He's part of the process, too. So we all get invited to certain bills if we've been voicing our opinions or working on. We get invited up to either testify or the county itself as a board. If we all agree, we support and send up support letters. And these are all very important because all these bills go to committees. And these committees then make a decision if they even get out and go to the floors of the Senate or the House for a vote. And if we don't push certain things that way, it never gets out of committee. And this is supposed to be, they say is going to be a record year for bills introduced, which I'm not all on top of these things. I think we just make up too many damn laws, but unfortunately, they're expecting probably better than 3,000 this year that's going to be put into all these committees. And how many will get out, we don't know. So we'll see. Okay, remind you that today at 1:30, we start our budget process. At 1:30, we have another meeting for our staff for the budget. And then don't forget that at 6:30, we have the PM tonight, is the 2nd District Volunteer Fire Department, one of our code home rule meetings. That's it. Down adjourned.